And we're just getting started. Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church of Denton. We're glad you're here. We invite you to register your attendance by filling out the connection card that you find in your bulletin. If you're watching us online, you can register your attendance at fumcdenton.com/live. As we're gathered together, please let us join together in our call to worship. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Let us walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, whatever your story or identity, God's grace is here for you, and so are we. So let us praise the Lord together. Our opening hymn is number 89, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Please stand as you are able.
Stand?
Let's stand.
Stand! And now let us pray. God of love, you teach us a life journey that calls us to deny what is unhealthy and unloving. Lead us in that pathway. Awaken us to the ever new abundance that is ours through your word. In the name of the one who died and rose, Jesus Christ, our Lord. who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. The Lord listens to the cries of the people who turn with full hearts to the one who has mercy. Let our tongues now make confession in the presence of God and of this body. Holy God, in the name of sin, our gravest enemy, we call to you for help. You know our fault before we speak. Forgive us for what we have in opposition to your will. Forgive us for those things we have not undertaken, but for which we know are wrong. We have not loved you and our neighbors as we ought. We have denied our dependence on you. Lead us away from the grief and sorrow. Save us that we may fulfill our vows to you and attend to the needs of your people. Amen. God, who is gracious and merciful, know that the human desire to save our lives by avoiding Jesus' call to carry the cross. God is full of compassion, also knows that those who repent have set their minds and hearts on what endures for all time. Our sins are forgiven. The Lord God is our very present help. Thanks be to God. Amen. Christ be with you. So with you. Please share the peace of Christ with one another in a creative way.
That's enough good being friendly. It's just too much love, too much love. Hi, Chase. Good morning, church. I'm Pastor Don, in case you're wondering. If I don't see you on the 4th, I want to wish you a happy Independence Day. I'm so happy to be with you this morning, especially on the heels of a week-long heat dome inspiring squirrels across North Texas to do something called splooting, is that? Splooting, stretching out on cool surfaces to reduce body heat. And I like how his tail is blowing high noon. And some of us will be splooting this afternoon as well, amen? That's right. So I want to express my deep appreciation to the Denton Community Band and members of the band under direction of Carolyn Mizell for their gift of music today. Let us celebrate together. And also, we so appreciate Carolyn Mizell. She has directed the community band, I am told, for 45 years. She started when she was 12, and I always tell the truth, sort of. As you may know, I was once an art major, and it was my grandfather who advised me, don't do it, there's no money in it. So I became a pastor. Come to think of it, Grandpa Henry didn't talk to me much after that. But framed in my office is a high school art project of an owl I did using a medium called scratchboarding. Anyone here ever do scratchboarding? You should try it. It's fun. Scratchboarding is a form of direct engraving, and the process involves taking a piece of scratchboard, which is basically ink dried in layers over cardboard, and methodically scraping away the ink with an X-Acto knife or some other sharp object. And as you carefully and selectively remove the ink, the white background is revealed, and it kind of captures an image as light falls on it. So basically the end result is a study in light, and that's my owl. And one thing I can tell you about scratchboarding is it's not very forgiving. Okay. If you make a mistake, you simply have to learn to live with it, because you can't put it back once it's scratched off. It's, you know, it's kind of like a memory foam mattress. Once you get it out of the box, it ain't going back, no matter how hard you try to get it back in that box. So we've been talking about wisdom in a series titled The Art of Wisdom, and the subtitle, Making Meaning Out of the Mess of Our Lives, or the Mess of Life. And we've been making our way through the book of James, which is a book credited to Jesus' younger brother. James merges what we understand to be Jewish wisdom tradition with, and that's kind of like Proverbs. Proverbs is Jewish wisdom tradition with the way and the teachings of Jesus. Wisdom is the biblical term for on earth as it is in heaven, everyday living. And that's a quote from the Message translation of the Bible. Wisdom is the art of living skillfully in whatever conditions we find ourselves in. James begins by telling his readers to consider trials, hardship, as joy. And that's going to be a hard sell, no matter how you put that. His next argument, however, is that his readers have every reason to be grateful. So James is writing to Jewish Christians who have been forced from their homes and scattered across foreign lands, living basically as refugees in exile. Despite this difficult reality that they find themselves in, James insists God is good, and God is the source of all good gifts, and not the giver of trials or gifts that hurt instead of heal us. So I'm going to be reading to you from James chapter 1 and reading verses 16 through 18, and I invite you, as you are able, to please stand for the reading of God's word. This is so cool to be eye level with the balcony people. This has never happened before. Here we go. Do not be deceived, my beloved. Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, God gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. The word of God for the people of God. Please be seated. So in case you were wondering, last Sunday I had the privilege of preaching both the Mosaic and the open service at 11 o'clock, and I talked about how the cracks in and of our lives allow God's gift of wisdom to settle in, you know, to create both character and depth while also enhancing the overall beauty of our distinct Christian identity. Today I want to talk about the wisdom of gratitude, the wisdom of gratitude. So, light that shines in the darkness. A couple weeks ago, I had the privilege of visiting with one of our members, Anna Mae Walter at Good Samaritan. Does anyone here know Anna Mae? Show of hands. Okay, yeah, she knows pretty much everyone. So she was getting ready to celebrate her 105th birthday. Now, I can't even begin to imagine how much change she has experienced in her life as a centenarian. And Anna Mae greeted me with this huge smile and this generous hug. And then, sitting me down, she pulled a photograph out of her Bible. In case some of you wonder, it's a piece of paper, has a picture on it. Looks a lot like what you see on your phones. And she showed it to me at some point in her ministry, in my ministry at First Time Methodist Church Denton. Someone had taken a photograph of us together. And Anna Mae had kept this photo in her Bible for all these years. Obviously, this is before the advent of color photography. So. Yes, I'm that old. So when I think about Anna Mae, I think about the light that she carries within her. Even as Anna Mae told me that she's ready to go, and I totally get that, that Anna Mae's flame still burns brightly. I mean, you can see it on her face. You can see it in her smile, her grateful heart, and her deep faith in God's love for her in Jesus Christ. None of that has diminished. And if it were in her power, Anna Mae would be with you, her church family, right now, sitting with you in worship, shining her inextinguishable light upon us while tapping her foot to the tunes of the music of the DCB. So there are four basic elements. Can you all name them? There's four. There's earth, there's air, there's water, and there's fire. There are more, but there are four basic. Okay, we're going to go with the basic. Okay, so there's a fifth element, but that's sci-fi. So across our scripture library, God is identified with each of the four elements. And in James, God is identified with the phos, I think is how it's pronounced, the phos. May the phos be with you. So it is light. It means light, or it means fire. And a derivation of phos is the word phosphorus, which literally means bearer of light. Phosphorus is bearer of light. So according to James, every generous act finds its origin in God, meaning when we see good in the world, we are seeing God at work. The word used here for God is the word pater, translated father. Pater is a metaphor for someone we derive life from. The source of all goodness and life, says James, is the pater, the God of fire and light. God's love shows up in Jesus and shines on the dark shadows of our world, drawing us closer to God. And if these words sound vaguely familiar, they're parallel John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and all things came into being through Him. And all things that came into being through Him, nothing was made that was not made. And what has come into being in Him was life, and that life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Amen. Amen. Out of the shadows. So I was a teenager at church youth camp when I fully embraced my Christian identity. I was drawn to the light I saw in other campers with me that was burning brightly in them. I want what they have. I distinctly remember thinking that. I want what they have. See, when we're drawn in, we become God's phosphorus. We become bearers of light. Like Anna Mae, God's love shines through us into the shadow places of our world to bring light and to bring love and to bring hope. And the more of us that shine together, the brighter the light. Friends, we need each other. I cannot tell you that enough and remind you enough. We need each other. Our connection to each other is essential to our identity and our spiritual life. We are better together. And what we can accomplish together is much more than the sum of the parts. This is part of the why of our gathering as a church. It's why, as a church, we feed hundreds of our unhoused neighbor every year through our first meal program. I was there this morning serving 30 to 40 of our unhoused neighbors communion, and they are a force to be reckoned with. What we accomplish together is so much more. It's why we are planning to build affordable housing on the back 40 of our property as a church, to bring hope and light and life to 180 families who need quality, affordable housing. And the spiritual practice of gratitude is, it's like glue. It's like glue that holds us together as a community. So I don't know if there are any photographers out there, but photographers use a term, and it's called Rembrandt lighting. Are any of you familiar with that? Rembrandt lighting. It's a nod to the Dutch painter Rembrandt. Good, you're following me. And his use of light to bring out the hidden details of his canvas out of the shadows. And you can see this on full display in his painting titled The Return of the Prodigal. I don't know if you can see that. Out of the shadows. God's fuss, God's light in our lives functions to reveal what is hidden, giving clarity and inspiring gratitude for the God who knows us intimately and loves us as is. And finally, the wisdom of gratitude. So 12 years ago, in Joplin, Missouri, a community memorial service took place following the touchdown of an EF5 tornado. It stayed on the ground for 32 minutes, tearing a 6-mile-long path of destruction through the heart of the city. It looked like a war zone. As the community gathered to grieve and comfort each other, Reverend Aaron Brown, pastor at St. Paul's United Methodist Church, spoke these words. Some of us are asking why God did this, or why God allowed this. So much death and destruction. But Jesus never promised that we would be protected from the storms of life. What Jesus did promise was to be with us through the storm, to be with us as we grieve, to be with us as we stand at the graveside of our loved ones, to be with us and listen to us and guide us. Our challenge is to let him. As hard as it may be, pray, talk to God, listen for God's voice. Let God love you. You may wonder at times, but the fact is God loves you. God loves Joplin. And God is walking with us through this tragedy and will make a way where it seems there is no way. While acknowledging their shared sense of loss, what Reverend Brown does is practice the wisdom of gratitude for the God who loves us and who goes with us on our journey, even and especially in those difficult times. Gratitude is an affront to the shadow places of our world. The capacity to find gratitude is more powerful than you can imagine. And when we practice gratitude together, we discover the gift of resilience. Resilience. Gratitude is an alchemist that turns sorrow into hope and sorrow into light. Just ask the people of Joplin. I did, as a member of a response team helping rebuild people's homes there. And what we heard was, remarkably, gratitude. Gratitude that God was with them, that God was speaking to their hearts, healing their wounds, and restoring their hope. They saw God at work in their lives through us, through each other. Wisdom inevitably births gratitude. The word gratitude comes from the word, same root word as grace, charis. Gratitude is a spiritual response to the goodness we experience in our life, a goodness, says James, that can be traced back to God. God is not only the source of all good gifts, God deserves our gratefulness. God doesn't need our gratefulness. We need to express it, to give it. The word the New Testament uses for gratitude is eucharisto, eucharisto, translated graceful or thankful. It's where we derive the word Eucharist, or another word for communion or the Lord's Supper. Gathering at this communion table is a subversive act of gratitude for the grace that God gives to us, the God who comes to us in Jesus, broken and poured out for us. God is good to us, even and especially in those difficult seasons of our lives, so that we might respond with worship and live grace-filled lives that bring God's love to each other. You are the light of the world. Some of you know this, right? You are the light of the world, Jesus tells his followers. So let your light shine that they may see your good works and give glory to God in heaven. Pater, the one who gives us life. The wisdom practice of gratitude not only helps us see good, the good that God is doing. Practicing gratitude opens up our eyes to see the needs of those around us so we can participate in the good that God is doing in the world. Just like our high school youth who just returned with the adult volunteers from Mississippi, a UM Army mission trip to build a wheelchair ramp to gift a family accessibility to their home. Our youth know what it means to become part of the good that God is doing in the world. Their lives have become a study in God's light. Our July Mission Corner is asking for gift cards for Rivera Elementary School to help buy school supplies. These gift cards fill a gap in the needs of the schools to provide specific supplies needed to teach students who come from primarily low-income families. Gratitude says, God has so blessed me. Now, let me bless you. Let me help. So next time you go to the grocery store, pick up a $25 or $30 gift card and bring it to church with you so you can contribute to that. You know, I think this 4th of July weekend is an awesome time, a great opportunity to give thanks for God's many blessings in our lives. And one of the things I'm grateful for as pastor is Pastor Martha Segundo. She's right here in the front. She is a member of our Jesus Fuente de Vida congregation. She received her call to ministry under Pastor Mauricio's leadership, a call confirmed by the members of that congregation, our SPRC, Staff Parish Relations Committee, and she has received training to be a local pastor. Martha will be serving the congregation of Jesus Fuente. With its current attendance, Jesus Fuente de Vida is sized right for a part-time local pastor. And given our budget deficit over the last few years, it just makes sense for us to reconfigure our staff to be strategically sustainable for the future. We are grateful for the work of our Staff Pastor Parish Relations Committee and trust in their leadership in staffing our church for ministry moving forward. There is great wisdom in the practice of gratitude. And honestly, we don't do it enough. Amen? So, I'd like to give you an opportunity to do that. So downstairs in Miller Center, if you go directly below us, you can write on a graffiti board. And I've written a prompt, a short question for you to answer. And here's the question. What about your church are you most grateful for? What about your church are you most grateful for? Your responses will be tabulated and winners will be contacted by mail, just so you know. And while you're a Miller, make a new friend or reconnect with an old one. Will you pray with me? God, help us to live this day as bearers of your light, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Spirit, help us to love our neighbor, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say, and let all God's people say. Amen.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, and those who seek him and seek to live in peace with one another. So come seeking the goodness of God who meets us here. As we prepare to come to the table, let us return to God the offerings of our life and the gifts of the earth. As Don mentioned, a group week before last, a group of high school students and adults went to Long Beach, Mississippi to do home improvements with the organization called UM Army. You saw a picture of the ramp we built, and I think we've got another one there, too. That's the finished product right there. The homeowner that lived there could only get out of his house with the assistance of his wife and daughter, and this wheelchair ramp enables him to get out of the house on his own. So we were grateful that we were able to be of service in that way. We're also grateful to you because your generosity helped make that trip possible, both through your support of youth fundraisers and also in your regular giving, a portion of which goes to our youth ministry budget. A reminder, you can give online by visiting fumcdenton.com/give or by texting FUMCDenton to 73256. God has given to us generously. Let us give generously.
Okay. Oh, we got it. With me in the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Glory to you, O God. In the beginning you spoke the word, you gave life to all the world. You created us in your image and called us to be your people. Even when we deny your word and betray the promise of our faith, you remain faithful in your love. So with those who have received your blessings in every age and place, with those who seek to be stewards here and now, we join our voices in praise to you. To you, O God, you love the world so much, you sent your only Son to save us. Jesus gives living water to those who are thirsty. He offers healing and grace to those who are suffering. And to those in the dust of death, he is resurrection and the life. As we remember the gift, we celebrate once again, as we celebrate the wonder of redemption, which is ours, we would cling to the mystery we call faith. And so we give thanks that on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, remember me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we now proclaim what is ours. We pray as Christ has taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. God has poured out his grace and spirit upon us, the body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ given for you. At this time, we'll invite you to come forward at the direction of our ushers, our servers, if they would also come forward at this time. As you'll be directed through the center aisles, you'll go to the station, I believe, to your left or your right. If you come through the center aisle, you go to your right. And then you'll be handed a piece of bread. You dip it in the juice and eat of it, and then simply return to your seats by the next aisle over. There is a gluten-free option here at the front. You're invited to ask for that so your server can provide it for you. There's also a communion offering. I'm not seeing the baskets for that, but if you'd like to leave a gift for our daily bread, that is the recipient of our communion offering, you can leave that on one of the two tables here at the front. Just simply leave a check or cash, and we'll make sure it gets to our daily bread. It's one of our ongoing ministries here in the community, and we're proud to be a part of the ministry and the work that they do to our unhoused neighbors. Let us now share in this holy feast.
Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks and praise. At this covenant meal, you have nourished us with your body and your blood. Sustain us with your spirit and send us forth singing praise until we feast with you again in the glory of your holy realm. Amen. Well, we're grateful that you've been here this morning to worship with us. Just a few announcements in the life of our congregation. This coming Saturday, a group of middle school students and adults are leaving on the middle school trip. I would love to tell you about it, except it's a mystery. They don't know where they're going, although they're kind of leaning forward at this moment right now. And also, a group of high school students and adults will be head out to high school camp this week. So keep our youth ministry in your prayers. It's a busy couple of weeks for us. Every Sunday morning, 10 o'clock in the west end of Miller Center, we have summer speaker sessions, a different speaker every Sunday. If you're not part of a Sunday school class or a regular group and just want to come and try that out and see what our speakers are saying, you're welcome. Once again, the west end of Miller Center, 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings. Our final hymn is number 102, Now Thank We All Our God. Please stand as you are able.
Thank you so much for spending this hour with us, whether you've been online or here in person. It's been a joy to have you here. Our deep appreciation to the Denton Community Band. Can we thank them again? And they'll be here next week. No, I'm just teasing, but no. That would be awesome, wouldn't it? Our apologies for a little bit of apparently squirrels carried off one of our chalices. So anyways, that happens. But we're so glad that you came together to worship. And I want to send you out this blessing. If you look at your life, and you see good, whatever that good is, God is at work. Do you know it? Do you believe it? Do you see it, that God is at work in your life to do you good and to do good through you in the world? Respond with gratitude for all the good gifts in your life, and then share that gratitude with the world. For the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.